and also welcome you here in the church, and also those that are watching us through Zoom, the Lord, and through Zoom, and also those that are watching us through Facebook and YouTube. I want to take this opportunity to welcome all of you. You're going to have a great, great time in the presence of the Lord. There is a preacher I had one day giving a story, and every time he would come to the congregation of his church, he would say, "And today the message is be born again." And the next day, the next Sunday would come, and he would still preach the same message, and he would say, "Today my topic, the topic of my message today is be born again." And then the next Sunday he came, and it was the same thing. And the elders of the church, called the pastor and told him, "Pastor, it looks like you're really, you're really going dry. Why are you only preaching to us the message of you must be born again?" And then he told his elders, the reason why I'm speaking this word is because there is great need right now. That is the primary message that everybody needs to get born again, or without which no one will go to heaven. Praise be to God. And I feel like that today, because the message that I'm bringing today is the Bible tells us that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so the topic of my message today is growing in a relationship with God. And I know we've spoken about this, last week, but I feel every time I go to prepare myself that God is drawing us towards himself. God is hungry for our fellowship. Amen. That's what we're going to share with us this morning. Amen. Amen. I want to thank God, and I want to trust that the Lord has protected each one of you and your families. We've had a wonderful time in the presence of the Lord in prayer. Today is the 14th day, and I hope that you have honored, the Lord by going in prayer and fasting. And I know for some of you, maybe you're doing 6 to 6. Some of you are probably doing a dry fast, which is okay. About denying ourselves, food. What we do is we are pressing down the desires of the flesh and elevating the spiritual man in us, and so that we can hear God clearly. Amen. There's something that happens when we subdue ourselves, and food is one of the primary things that we all need, to survive. And so we are telling God, from 6 to 6, I'm just going to drink water. I'm just going to sip something. And I'm going to dedicate the 12 hours before your presence, Lord. May you speak to me. And let me tell you, when you say something, when you declare something like that, the Lord is going to bless you. I know for some of you who are working, it might be difficult, but you can do something. You can say, Monday or the days that I'm off, I am going to go into the presence of the Lord, and the Lord is going to honor you. Praise be to God. Amen. Growing our relationship with God is the most fundamental and crucial decision that a born-again Christian can make. It is the greatest decision that we can make. And God longs for our fellowship. And I can't really overemphasize that if there is anything in God's heart, regarding his children, is that we may draw closer to him the more. There's a scripture that says that when we draw closer to him, he also draws closer to us. And in heaven, that is his dwelling place. God is omnipresent. He dwells everywhere. But I wanna think of heaven as his primary residence. That is where he has his throne. And when he thinks about you and me, he says, "Oh, how I long that they would come and call upon my name. How I long that they would come and leave everything else and just dedicate their lives to me." And so today we're going to check on a few things that we need to do in order for us to grow ourselves or our relationship with God. Praise be to God. Amen. That we know that no one can ever come to, as long as we are on this earth, come to 100% optimal relationship with God. And there are things that impede us from reaching to that goal. And mainly what some of those things is just lingering sin. We know that when we got born again, the Bible says that, that we were saved by grace through faith. And so behold, everything that has come to us, you know, behold, our life is brand new. But it's that inclination of our bodies to tend to sin. And therefore, that's why, you know, the Lord wants to come, the Lord desires that we may come into his presence every day. You know, Paul, Apostle Paul, you know, is a man that we know that that dedicated his life completely to him. And if there's any apostle apart from, you know, our Lord Jesus Christ, who of course was God and he was the Son of God, who completely dedicated his life, was Apostle Paul. And many times, you know, he spoke and of his vulnerabilities and the thing, you know, he did the things that he was not supposed to do, even though he desires to do certain things in order to please God. But he found himself doing things that he did not want to do. But the one thing that Apostle Paul, you know, ensured in his life, he said, pressing towards the mark of perfection. Amen. And we as Christians also, we ought to press towards that mark of perfection. When God, you know, comes for us, you know, when our bodies will be glorified and we are living with him forever and ever in heaven, then we shall have glorified bodies and we shall attain perfection at that particular point. Amen. And so Paul in the book of Philippians, chapter number 3, verses number 8, this is what he says. Yet indeed, I also count all things as lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ. You know, Paul, you know, made this statement. It was a very profound statement, saying that, you know, he was determined to lose everything in this life compared to the excellency of gaining the knowledge of Christ in him. And he had suffered loss for everything, you know, in exchange of loving Christ. And I pray that we shall be like him. We shall emulate him. Where at one point he says that I emulate Christ just as I want you to emulate me, as I emulate Christ. Paul was determined to count everything as lost compared to the pursuit of Jesus Christ, his master, his Lord and Savior. And having said that, there are two things that is important to note, that it takes two to tango. It takes two to be in a relationship. Amen. You know, if you're married, you know, you have a relationship with your spouse. So in a relationship, God himself, number one, longs for that relationship. God is the partner in this relationship. The Holy Spirit is also the partner in that relationship. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, is a partner in the relationship in which we have with him. And so him, he has played his part. He says that I desire and I long to have you. As a matter of fact, in the book of Matthew 11, 28 to 19 to 29, Matthew 11, 28 to 29. This is a scripture that we all know. But this is what Jesus speaks to us, saints. He says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Praise be to God. Amen. So Jesus explains, he says, you know, he already explains to us his position and his attitude, that his attitude is one of gentleness, and that if we can come to him, he is not the one who is going to come and spike us. You know, there's sometimes in a relationship, when you're in a relationship and you know you've wronged the other person, you sometimes, you know, fear to approach the other person because you don't know how they are going to react to you. But Jesus says, come unto me just as you are. Praise the Lord. I'm lowly of spirit. So in other words, I'm not going to lord over you. Even though I'm God, I'm going to take you at the place of, you know, at your place, at the position of a human being. I'll be lowly to you. I'm gentle. Amen. In the spirit. Praise be to God. Amen. And he says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I'm gentle and I'm lowly in the spirit, and you'll have rest for your soul. I want to be in a relationship. It is a great thing to know. But we want to be in a position, in a relationship whereby when I'm in the presence of my partner, or when I'm in the presence of the other member of the relationship, that I'll find rest. Amen? And God tells us, come to me, all ye who labor, and I'll give you rest. You will find rest in my presence. Praise be to God. Don't you thank God because he says that when we come to him, that we can find rest. Rest from all the labors that we go through, all the stresses of life that we encounter, all the troubles and the problems that we don't even have solutions for. That when we toil and wonder, you know, how we are going to go about our day-to-day affairs, that there is one, a member of the relationship that is calling us to himself. And he says, you know what, if you can come to me, not only am I going to be gentle to you, but you will find rest in all your toils, praise be to God. And that is a very important thing to know, that God is open, has open arms, willing and ready and able to accept us just as we are. Today, we can make that decision. We can make that decision to say, Lord, I will approach your throne. Lord, I would want to come to you because when I come to you, not only will I be in the same level with you, you'll be able to understand what I'm going through, but you'll be able to give me a place where I can rest all my fears. You'll be able to give me a place whereby I can rest from all the things that I stress from today in the name of Jesus. Now, the other thing also that we have is important for us to note that a relationship is can never be called a relationship unless two of those people agree. You know, we also have a part to play that we can draw close to his presence, praise be to God. We can intentionally make that as a decision, knowing that the Father is always willing to be approached by us, but you know, he will never force himself into us. Praise be to God. Even though he longs that we may come to him, he also wants us to make an intentional step towards drawing closer to him. Praise be to God. Amen. Amen. We can make that decision. We can make that decision to draw closer to him. In Prophet Isaiah 26, verse number 9, hear the fear his desire. Hear the desire and that came from his heart. This is what he says in Isaiah 26. Verse number 9, that at night my soul longs for you. Amen. So Isaiah had come to a place whereby he had experienced so many things in the world. And the moment he tasted Christ, the moment he tasted the love of God, you know, he couldn't let go. Amen. And he comes and says, at night my soul longs for you. Indeed, my spirit within me seeks you diligently. Amen. So Isaiah knew the place where he would come and rest, you know, away from all the messages that God was using him to proclaim over the land of Israel. Some of those messages were hostile and people were, you know, not everybody celebrated what he was speaking to the nation of Israel. And so he found a refuge in God. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. And I love this. Indeed, my spirit within me seeks you diligently. Amen. For when the earth experiences your judgment, the inhabitants of the world learns righteousness. Praise be to God. There's also a man of old who also was inclined to the presence of the Lord. His name was David. Amen. And in the Psalm 73, verse number 25, this is what he says. Whom have I in heaven but you? In other words, he says, is there anyone that I can put my trust in on this planet? No, I don't have anyone. Who do I have here on earth and in heaven but you, O Lord? And besides you, I desire nothing on earth. Now, this is a statement of a man who has tasted the goodness of God. He has seen how God has delivered him from many, many a trouble. He saw God delivering him while he was taking care of his father's sheep in the desert, where God was able to give him the strength to destroy and kill bears and lions. Praise be to God. And he knew that he couldn't do by his own strength. And there are many, many probably other miracles that the Lord performed through David. And he says, when he is able to check on all the accounts of what the Lord had done to him, he comes and says, whom do I have in heaven but you? And besides you, I desire nothing on earth. Don't you think it would be a great thing when we look back and see how God has been faithful? God has protected us. God has provided for us. God has given us access to many other things that millions and millions of people in the earth today would desire, even to be where you are, or even to just test the littlest, the smallest of the things that you have. But God, it is not because we did anything so special that those people didn't do. Amen? But it is just because of his favor. Now, when I look at the account of God's goodness and what he has done for me, no wonder there's a song that sings, a singer sang and said, when I think about his goodness and all that he has done for me, I can dance and dance and dance and dance and dance because he is majestic and he is powerful and he is awesome. And we can approach his throne this morning and we can find rest. Amen. In the book of Psalm 63, verses number 1, this is a psalm of David. And this is what it says. When he was in the wilderness of Judah, O God, you are my God. I shall seek you honestly. Amen. I shall seek you honestly. In other words, I want to come into your presence. I want to experience there is all there is in you, O Lord. I want to ask, you know, I want to seek you honestly. There's no way we can seek God honestly, if that seeking is not coming from our heart, from a place of recognizing who God is, that he is the creator of heaven and earth, hallelujah, that he is the one who ordains every purpose and everything here on earth, and he is the one who says, I will seek you honestly, praise be to God. And then he says, my soul thirsts for you, oh hallelujah, my soul thirsts for you, my flesh yearns for you. Think about that statement by itself. Think about when you're thirsty and you need a drink. You know, you can go, you can do whatever it takes to get a drink. Have you ever been thirsty? Have you ever thirst, you know, the natural thirst? You want to take a drink so bad and you know that you need it and you can pay for anything, you know, to quench that thirst. And this is exactly what David explains here. And he says, my soul thirsts for you. My flesh yearns for you in a dry and weary land where there's no water. And my soul thirsts for you. In 2021, that is my prayer. I want to thirst and I want to yearn for him. I want to do whatever it is that I can do within my capability to draw closer to God. And the Bible says that when we draw closer to him, he will also draw closer to us. That's what the Bible says in the book of James chapter number 4. That when we draw closer to him, he will also draw closer to us. So church, let us draw close to God. Let us seek him. He is hungry. He is desiring every time. Oh, he thinks about you and he says, oh, when was the last time I really had a heart-to-heart talk with my daughter? When was the last time I had a heart-to-heart talk with my son? You know, sometimes he comes in my presence and he speaks so hurriedly. And he says amen and he goes away. And he doesn't even wait for me to even speak in a relationship. In a relationship, you know, people talk to each other. Amen. In a relationship, I talk. And also, there's a time for me to stop talking. And I listen to what you have to say. Because we are in a relationship. Amen. We are in a relationship. Praise be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, there are five things that I want us to check that we can do to grow and maintain our relationship with God. I want to talk about these five things. I hope I'll be able to finish. But even if we don't finish them today, we'll continue next time. Amen. Amen. So I thought about it and I said, so in order for me to draw closer to God and to grow my relationship with God, what are some of the things that are very critical? There are so many things. But the first thing that came into my mind, if I'm in a relationship with my wife, I'm in a relationship with my wife, and if you're, most of you who are married, you have a relationship with your spouse. You know, when you're in a relationship, there are certain things that people do in a relationship that injure or kind of like mess up that relationship, so that relationship is not only always 100%. You know, somebody will say something that somebody didn't like and they are going to be hurt, you know. And somebody in a relationship maybe is going to act do some things that the other person doesn't like. And so that, you know, there's a moment in that relationship whereby people become so a little bit distant, even though they're still in a relationship, but they are a little bit distant. And so I thought, okay, so what do we need to do? So I thought of saying daily habit of confessing our sins to God and to each other and asking for forgiveness. You know, the Bible says, there's a scripture that says that if we cannot love the person that I'm looking at or the person that is next to me who is my neighbor, how can I say that I love God? So God says, first of all, we need to have love between each other, that we need to respect one another. We need to honor one another. We need to, we need to esteem one another. Praise be to God. And so it is very, very important, as long as we are living in this life, to ask God for forgiveness, you know, I mean, forgiveness with people that we are interacting with every day. And it's important for us to be cognizant when we are at fault, to be ready to say, I am sorry, to be ready to say, please forgive me, to come and say, you know what, that word that I spoke to you the other day, it was not intended to be made. I think I'm above that. I'm not supposed even to have said that word. And please, would you forgive me? Amen. Daily habit of confessing our sins to God and to each other and asking for forgiveness. Praise the Lord. On a personal level, the Bible says in the book of James 5:16, and I think for those who were able to join on Friday, I think we checked on this this scripture. James 5:16, this is what the Bible says. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. Consider what that scripture says, that we ought to confess our sins to each other and pray for each other so that we may be healed. God the Father intends that even as we think about a relationship with him, that we also mind about the relationship that we have with one another. And you know, while we are together, as long as we are here on earth, we think differently, we have been created differently, and somebody somewhere at some point is going to say a word that is unkind to somebody. Somebody somewhere is going to do an activity that the other person doesn't like. Praise be to God. And so the Bible says that when we have come into such a situation, when we have sinned to each other, that we ought to confess our sins to each other. You know, let me tell you, there are many people, millions and millions in the world today, that are sick today just because of things that have been done to them by other people. Unkind words. There are people who are sick emotionally. There are people who are sick mentally today because of words that were spoken, you know, to them by their people that love them so much. And there are people who are completely right now hurt down to the core. The moment, you know, you feel that you have an emotional breakdown in the soul just because of words that have been spoken to you by your loved one, a person that you love, or the moment that you spoke some words and you came to realization, you know what, this thing that I said, this thing that I did to the other person really hurts me so bad. I wish I can get together with this other person so that I can reconcile. As long as that is not done, it can cause sickness and illness. Praise be to God. And that's why James admonishes us to keep short accounts with people. The moment you come to realize you're bad, the moment you come to recognize of your fault, please approach your other partner and tell them, hey, you know what? You know, come down, humble yourself and tell your partner, I know that I did this. And I'm sorry for what I did, and I'm asking you to forgive me. Let me tell you, the moment you humble yourself, it is always the other person will be always ready. They may not be in a position to forgive you because they've been so much hurt. But as you continue to pray and to plead for forgiveness, God is also going to work in their hearts, and they're going to forgive you. Praise God. So when our horizontal relationship has been taken care of, our vertical relationship is also taken care of. Amen. There's a scripture in the Bible that talks about the relationship between a man and a wife, a husband and a wife, that when they are not together, when they have, you know, hurt each other. I think it is in the book, I can't remember where it says, you know, that we ought to pray to the Lord. It's, you know, to forgive and to seek for forgiveness with each other, so our prayers are not hindered. Amen. So God is not going to honor our prayer if our horizontal relationship is not taken care of, brothers and sisters. So let us, you know, work as hard as we can, and as hard as the Holy Spirit helps us, to make sure that our horizontal relationship has been taken care of, so that our prayers are not hindered. Amen. In the book of 1 John chapter 1, verse number 9, this is what the Bible says. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and he will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Amen. God is desiring that we may go into his presence. But you know, God cannot entertain sin. God is a righteous and holy God. And so when we come to him, the first thing that he wants us to do is approach him as recognizing his purity and his holiness. And so as I come before the presence of the Lord, the first thing that I do is to tell the Lord, Lord, please forgive me. I may have said a word that was unkind to you. I may have allowed a thought to come into my mind that was unholy before you. So Lord, please, may you forgive me. Search my heart. You know, David was constantly asking the Lord to search his heart. Praise be to God. Search my heart, O Lord. Yes, renew my heart. Yes, Father, I ask you, Lord, to forgive me of anything that I may have promised you, Lord, and I failed to do it. See, the Lord, the things that we say to God, church, he keeps a record of everything that we say. And so when we promise to do something, when we promise to love him with the whole of our hearts and we fail to do so, it's also a sin before him. And so we need to come to him and tell him, Lord, I can't stand before your presence and guilty, and I ask you to forgive me. Amen. And the Lord is ready to come and forgive us of all our sins and our unfaithfulness. And he is ready to embrace us so that we can have a rest. Amen. I thought of a healthy relationship can yield great benefits to its participants. When you have a healthy relationship with one another, you know, a healthy relationship, there's gonna be a growth, you know. There's gonna be growth when two people are in a relationship and there is just a harmony that is going, you know, during their relationship, there's gonna be growth. There's gonna be progress, amen? Amen, because you are agreeing. You know, God commands a blessing where there is unity, amen? And so there's gonna be growth. In a healthy relationship, there's gonna be love, amen? Many people, you may not have, you know, the material things of this world, but as long as you have a healthy relationship, that is a good ground for love to be nurtured. Your children are going to experience that love. Praise be to God. When there's a healthy relationship, there's going to be harmony. Amen. Harmony is needed in every family. Praise be to God. We need to agree in certain things that we ought to do as a family. And so when there's a healthy relationship, when people are speaking kind words to each other, when people are not doing bad things or activities behind the scenes to harm the other partners, you know, God is going to command a blessing and there's going to be a harmony. Amen. But a good relationship also can be messed by mean words, you know, unkind words. You know, there are people who do not care what kind of words that come out of their mouth. You know, there are people who can speak literally anything. In life, let me tell you, you'll come across those people. It could be in your place of work. It could be a place where you have your friends. There are people who carelessly speak words without caring whether those words are going to hurt other people. So we need to be measured in the way we speak. So mean words can mess up a healthy relationship, amen? Mean actions, you know, you're doing things purposely to hurt the other person. Activities that you do so that the other person can fail, so that the other person can look bad, amen? God commands us to cover, you know, love can cover a multitude of sin. Amen. Amen. With love, you know, I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and I was telling him, sometimes you can never get 100% from your friends. You can never get 100% from the people that you love. And sometimes you'll be called upon to look away when certain things are being done. Amen. It is not a healthy thing to always criticize, Amen. There are people who have a critical spirit. You know, they see somebody removing even a cup from the table and they want to criticize even the way you're picking up that cup. You know, there are people who have a critical spirit, you know. They see the way you do your things or the way you are walking and they want to criticize the way you walk. They criticize, they see they are critical in everything. Sometimes, brothers and sisters, we may have to look away and allow and give grace so that that person can know that you're loved. Imagine there's so many things that we do as the children of God. If God would come and really target on everything that we do to our God, and he says, oh, look at you, my child. Why are you doing those things? How many times do you think, children of God, that God looks away and he says, you know what? My grace is sufficient and I'll still bring him back. I know what he's doing is not right, but when he comes into my life, when he comes, he draws closer to me, I'll reveal what he did and I'll show him love and he'll be able to come out of that thing. Amen. We shall win people by the love of Christ. Amen. I'm not saying that we don't criticize, but we can criticize with love. There are moments, you know, this, you know, the Bible says in the book of Ecclesiastes, there's time for everything. There's time to sit down and evaluate the things that we do to each other. And we, at that time, you can criticize with love, but not criticize to injure or to hurt. Are we together, children of God? Amen. A good relationship can be messed about by biting and backstabbing. A good relationship can be messed up by hypocrisy. Amen. Hypocrisy is when you appear to be a friend of someone or to be doing a good thing to benefit the other one, but your intentions are really evil. Your intentions are for their downfall. Amen. Have you ever experienced people who are hypocritical? They tend to show you like they're your friends. But let me tell you, far from it, they're not even your friends. You'll be amazed how many people are really friends in need and also friends indeed. And so God has given us the spirit of discernment to know who people are. And even those people who are hypocritical, we are supposed to love them and win them to Christ so that they can love genuinely. Are we together? Hallelujah. Amen. Now, these things that we talked about here, betray a relationship, you know, love and trust in a relationship. And there's also loss and trust when these things are spoken in a relationship. Amen. So I was saying that we need to recognize our fault when we are at the wrong, come to the other person and ask them, please forgive me. Confess our sins to one another, seeking for forgiveness. Amen. Confession is more than just saying, I'm sorry, church. When we say, I'm sorry, it should not just be coming from our mouth. Even when we come to God and ask you, Lord, I am sorry. May you forgive me. It needs to come from the position of our hearts, where we recognize that sin is an abomination to the Lord and that it caused his son, Jesus Christ, to hang on the cross. And so when I'm coming, if I've done something wrong and I'm coming before the Lord and I'm telling him, Lord, I'm sorry. I want it to come from the core of my heart. And when I tell him I want to repent, I want to do a 180. You know, 180 degree is when you're going this way and you realize you're going the wrong direction. And 180 is when you turn back and you go towards the right direction. Amen. So we are doing a 180. Praise be to God. Hallelujah. Amen. There's a prayer that was made by a guy I was teaching on Friday. It's called the Republican. It is found in the book of Luke 18. And this is a very, very wonderful story. It's about the Pharisee, a Pharisee and a guy who was a Republican. I think it was the tax collector. And so the Pharisee comes and he says, oh God, you know, I give my 10%. I even pray. I attend the fellowship. I do all these other things. And he's saying these things publicly. You know, the Lord is giving this story. And you know what, Lord, I am better. I am more better than these other people who do not even come to the church or do other these other things. And then the Lord was also speaking about a publican, a tax collector. And he was worshiping God from afar, beating up his chest and telling Lord, he could not even look at the Lord because he felt like he was unworthy. He could have been doing the same things that the Pharisee was doing, but he was not ready to brag about those things. But he felt unworthy before the Lord. And he came and asked the Lord, please forgive me. I am a sinner. And he could not even come close to the Lord. He felt like, I'm not even worthy to come close to him. And you know, finally, the Lord concludes in that story and he says, who do you think went home justified? He said, the one who went home justified is the tax collector, the publican, because of his humility. He was humbled to come before the Lord. Brothers and sisters, I pray that we shall humble ourselves before the Lord, that we shall know it is by his grace that we are born again. Amen. That he took his son, Jesus Christ, to hang on the cross. And when we come to him, let us ask him, Father, I know I don't deserve what you have given me. I don't even deserve, Lord, even to be in your presence, Lord, right now. But I thank you because of Jesus, your son. Thank you because of the Holy Spirit today. Amen. And that is the prayer. The prayer, the Bible says that a broken spirit and a contrite heart, Lord, that kind of a prayer, the Lord will not despise. Amen. In Psalm 51:17, it says the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite spirit, oh God, you will not despise. I'm here to see a man who went to the Lord broken in his spirit and telling God, I'm here, Lord. Servant that you have created you in your own, for your own pleasure. And Lord, may you have mercy upon me. That kind of a prayer, the Lord will never ever despise. Amen. So let us be men and women who desire to go before the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. The next thing that I thought that was very important is daily listening to God when he speaks. Daily listening to God when he speaks. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, what happens when two people are in a relationship, can't talk or listen to one another? You know, if you're married, it is not a question of if, but it's a question of when. Maybe your spouse will say something that you didn't like and you shut down and you decided you're not going to speak, okay? And you could be related to a friend and maybe they said some unkind words and you decided, you know what, I'm keeping off for the next few days. I'm not going to talk to them because of the way they spoke to me, you know. But in during that time, there's tension. During that time, there's bad things that are happening to each other. You know, both parties are thinking how bad the other person is. The relationship is still there, but people need to come together and talk. And so daily listening to God as he speaks is very paramount. We should not only go to God in prayer and speak and speak and speak, but we need to have some time whereby we can sit down, be still, and listen to what he says. Amen. The Bible says in the book of Peter 1:19, okay? 2 Peter 1:19, and I love this scripture. It says, and we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention as a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Amen. Praise God. And in the book of Hebrews chapter number 1:1-2, the Bible says that in the past, and this is exactly what God used to do in the Old Testament. In the past, God used to speak to our fathers through the prophets and in many portions and in many ways. These last days, God has spoken to us through his son. Amen. He appointed heir of all things from whom all he has made the world and he is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature. Amen. God, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father, speaks to us today through his son, Jesus Christ. Amen. And he speaks to us through the scriptures. Praise be to God. The scripture in the book of 2 Timothy 3:16, it is God breathed and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, express disapproval, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Praise be to God. The Father today speaks to us through his Son. And you know what? The Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, the Word was with God, the Word was God, and the Word became flesh, and the Word is God, is Jesus himself. Amen. So the word, these scriptures that I hear is Jesus himself. Amen. This is Jesus himself. And that's how he speaks to us. And so the Father wants us to be partners with him in the work that he has here on earth. Amen. And so he is going to use, he uses Jesus to speak to us. Amen. In the old times, in the Old Testament, as we saw, he used the prophets, you know, to speak to people. But nowadays he speaks to us through his word. And that scripture that we just read there in 2 Timothy, that it is important for Jesus to speak to us. Amen. It is profitable for teaching because Jesus, the Father, wants us to be trained in the workmanship which he has called us to do. How are we going to learn what to do and when to do it? We are going to be taught by the scriptures. Amen. For reproof, he knows reproofing is the speaking against certain things that are happening within our lives. So the scriptures also, Jesus speaks to us to disapprove of certain things that he sees maybe in our midst. Amen. So when we allow him to speak, we allow him to correct us. Amen. We are allowing him to train us in righteousness. We are also allowing him to speak, and so that we can be complete, and so that we can be equipped in every good work. Jesus is the master teacher. Jesus is the master trainer. Amen. And so he is longing to speak to us, that he may train us. It is the intention of God that we all may be equipped for the good work of the ministry. Praise be to God. Amen. God is calling on each one of us to be the ones who delivers the good news of the kingdom. But how are we going to deliver the good news, the good message of the kingdom of God, if we have not heard and been trained by our Lord Jesus Christ? So we cannot separate ourselves from this, because this is the voice of Christ. Amen. This is the voice of Christ, church. So if we don't have, if we don't spend time with God, guess what? We are not listening to him. Amen. But the moment we are reading scripture, Jesus' voice is speaking to us. And in a relationship, I don't want to be in a relationship whereby, like with my wife, and I don't talk to her, like, you know what, baby, I'll talk to you on Friday. Think about that relationship. If you're in a relationship and you talk to your wife, maybe after 2 days and you're in the same house, really, 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 unless something is wrong, you want to be talking to each other. Amen. And that's how it is in a relationship. We have to, God speaks to us and we also speak to him. So we cannot separate ourselves from the scripture, because that's how God, the Lord, is going to speak to us. Amen. We together? Amen. Amen. So regular reading of God's word causes us to listen to God as he speaks through his word by the Spirit who breaks it down to us. Amen. Kind of like the scripture is that light. Is that light that Peter talks about, that shines in the darkness, so that you'll be able to see it. So that's how the scripture is. You know, we are able to hear his voice in the midst of so many other voices that we are surrounded by. Amen. Now the third one, and I think this is going to be my last one for today. It is speaking to God. Amen. Speaking to God. Now, the only means the Lord has provided for us to speak to him is through prayer. Amen. Prayer is the only means that we have right now that God has given us that we can speak to him. Amen. And prayer is just, prayer is not complicated. Prayer is an act of communicating with the deity. That's what actually the definition of prayer. In this case, it is the mode of communication from us directed to God. Amen. Is in a relationship, you need to be talking to each other again, as I say that. So in prayer, it is the forum that God has provided for us to pray. Now, Jesus molded this lifestyle here on earth. You remember the prayer that he taught his disciples? Disciples come to him and they tell him, Lord, we don't even know how to pray. Now, there's a format of how we approach God. And this is very critical that we learn this today. In the prayer of Jesus, you realize this is what I call the 3-3 principle. You know, how do we pray? Our Father who art in heaven. So in the first place, we are recognizing that there is a Father who is the Father of us all, and his dwelling place is where? Is in heaven. We are recognizing that he is a party to our relationship. And then he says, hallowed be thy name. In other words, Lord, I adore you. You are great. You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And Lord, hallowed be your name. Lord, it is such an honor that you've given me this privilege to come into your presence. And here I come to recognize your sovereignty, your greatness, your awesomeness. Amen. And what does it say next? Your kingdom come. Amen. So in other words, what is in heaven, Lord, what is there in heaven, I want also to experience it here. Don't you think that is a wonderful prayer? That you can experience what right now is happening in heaven. Praise be to God. That access has been given to a child of God. May your kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. In other words, Lord, let your glory come down here so that where you are, I can also experience. Beloved, we can experience the presence of God here on earth just as it is in heaven. Amen. So before we even talk about telling him, Lord, I need this, I need the other, God expects us, first of all, to recognize that he is God. The second thing he wants us to do as we approach God through prayer, he wants us to recognize his sovereignty, his greatness, that he is in a class of his own, church, that he cannot be compared with any other, that he is the sovereign God, the creator of the universe, the creator of the human beings and every living thing that there is. We acknowledge what he has done. And then we tell him, Lord, even where you are, I may not be there physically, but I can experience it here. Amen. I can experience your presence. I can experience the miracles. I can experience your awesomeness. I can experience, you know, your knowledge right now. Amen. Powerful prayer. Amen. And then the other three parts, what does it say? Give us what? Our daily bread. Now we come to a point where now we begin to tell him, Lord, I've acknowledged you, I've worshipped you, and your kingdom is here with me. Lord, you know what? Please provide for my daily bread. These are my needs. These are my requests. I'm praying you to help me to forgive those who have wronged me, just as you have forgiven me. You know, now it comes to the horizontal affairs whereby, Lord, I want you to provide for me. Help me, Lord, even to stay in peace with this other person that I really don't like them, but Lord, please help me so that I can forgive them. You know, please forgive me, and as I forgive those who have wronged me, Lord. And now it comes to the common denomination. And that's also what it says as we go down there in the book of, in the book of Philippians 4:6. Philippians 4:6, can we go there? Very, very powerful scripture about prayer. This is what it says. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. Amen? Don't worry about anything, but in everything through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. In other words, the mode of approaching God is also, Paul also spoke it to the church in Philippi. He tells them, when we approach God, let us come to him, first of all, to acknowledge in prayer, communication, telling him who he is. Amen. And also a supplication is the action of asking or begging for something honestly or humbly. Asking the Father God, I acknowledge your lordship. I acknowledge your sovereignty. I acknowledge that you're the King of kings. You are the God. Without you, there is no other. And Father, I thank you for the so many things that you've done. Father, I thank you for saving me. Thank you for my friends. Thank you for my family. Thank you for the sound of mine. Thank you for giving me a place here in a land called America. Thank you for all the things that you've done. Finally, after we have acknowledged, let me tell you, when you have come into that position whereby we have acknowledged his lordship, we have hallowed his name, and we have given thanks for all the things that he have done, then he says, now, after you have done those things, tell me about the horizontal things that are taking place in your world. Amen? Let your request be known to God. Let your request. You know, there was a time when I would come to God, and the moment I come to God, Father, I need this. Father, I need this. Until I realize how I'm doing it is not the right way. I need, first of all, to acknowledge that he is the Lord. Amen. I acknowledge him. the Father, you are the Father. It is an honor that you are my Father. Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for what you have done. Thank you. You are holy. You are mighty. And then I'll come and thank him and for the things. Thank him for my family. Thank him for my kids. Thank him for the church, the ECC. Thank him for his favor. Thank him for his protection. Thank him for, I mean, there are so many things the Lord has done. But finally, as I come to conclude, I tell him, Lord, there's this thing that is a thorn in my flesh. Can you help me uproot it? Amen. I deal with my request in the end. Praise be to God. Hallelujah. Now, when we do these things, God is going to bless us in a relationship, as I conclude, and as Brother Kimodo prepares to come, in a relationship, these things are very important. We have to speak to each other. Amen? Just as in a home. Think of it, of a relationship in a home. You have to keep on communicating with each other. Even in the, it may not be complicated things. Hey, so-and-so, can you go to the store, bring me this thing? You are communicating throughout the day. Even your husband might be working or your wife may be at work, but you're texting each other. You're communicating with each other. And so the Father also wants us continuously to be communicating. Let me tell you, I could be sitting in a meeting, and I'm telling you this because you can do it, and I can switch immediately. And for a moment, I'm talking to God and I'm telling God, I'm just loving you, Lord. Thank you so much for the opportunity that you afforded me. And I'm in a meeting and thank you, Lord, because of the things that you've done. I could be laying down in a coach and even watching something, a program, and I'm switching and I find myself communicating and I'm telling, Father, thank you for my kids. Thank you, Lord, for my wife. Thank you, Father, for the things that you've done, Lord. And by the way, there's that thing that I was telling you the other day, and please don't forget about it. I know God doesn't forget, but sometimes I'm telling him like that. You can switch. You can do this while you're driving. You know, you could be listening to a song and you can talk to God. You can have a conversation literally anywhere you want. Amen. Anyway, I have to come to a stop. May God bless you. We'll continue next time. I'm loving this. I want us to be men and women, let me tell you, who can draw closer to God. That is my heart desire. Because when you draw closer to God, he will also draw close to us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much, Daddy. We appreciate you for who you are. We acknowledge that you're God in heaven, and hallowed be your name. Thank you because there's no name given in heaven. Oh, yes, that is greater than your name. You're in a class of your own, Heavenly Father. And Lord, we are thanking you. We appreciate you for who you are to us. We worship you. Created us, Lord, to worship you, oh God. And we are thanking you, Father. We appreciate you, Lord. Father, let your kingdom come. Just as it's in heaven, let it be here on earth, that we may experience the things that are taking place in heaven. Oh God, thank you so much for who you are. We want to experience your presence right here, right now, in our bodies, in our present stage, in the name of Jesus. And Father God, I pray for my brothers and sisters. I pray that you shall minister to them in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that it will be the heart's desire of each and every one of us to draw closer to you. Because when we do so, you also shall draw closer to us. Father, as we continue in prayer, may you give strength to each and every one of us. And as we join the Church of the Highlands every morning, oh God, with your prayer points, oh God, and as we call upon your name, Father, I pray that we shall experience even a transformation from inside out in the name of Jesus. Father, we give you praise and we honor your name. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. There could be somebody watching us today. And you know what? You've heard the word of God many, many times. And you know what? The Bible says this, church. It says this, brother and my friend, that the Lord knocks at the door of your heart. If you can respond and say, come into my heart, you know, you can be born again. You know, and you can say a prayer like this. And I can lead you in a prayer. If you want to make that decision right now, you know, I want you to pray this prayer. Pray it with me. Say, Father, I acknowledge that I've done some wrong things to you. And I know that I couldn't measure up to your goodness and mercy. And this word that I had here today is so transformative. I pray, Lord, that you may come into my heart. I want to believe with my heart, just as you say, you've used that preacher, you know, talking about, you know, a life that is well lived with God. I want you to allow you to come into my heart. Get into my heart right now. Help me, Lord, even to believe in you in the name of Jesus. And Father, I want to tell others what you've done here today. And I accept you as Lord and my Savior. I don't want to go to hell. I want to live eternally with you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Friend, if you pray that prayer, I'd like to ask you to look for a Bible-believing church. Go introduce yourself to somebody you know is a Christian. Go to church this Sunday and tell the pastor of that church that you gave your life to Jesus. You know, better still, you can go to our website and you can come over through our Zoom meetings and you continue to grow in the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. May the Lord God bless every one of you. I hope you've received the word of the Lord gladly. And may God really, really, really bless every one of you. God bless you. Amen. I invite you. Okay, Joe.